Hi everyone. In the previous part, we had gone through food safety introduction. Now, in this part, we will discuss about food safety issues. So, food safety issues is going to be ultimately deals with the consumption stage where the existence and level of the dangers caused by foods are of chief concern. There are many food safety hazards or issues that cause food contamination. And these hazards may be introduced into the food supply at any time during harvesting, processing, transporting, and storing. Now, the most of the food safety hazards fall into one of the three categories or four categories. One is going to be of microbiological or biological hazards or issues. The second one is physical hazards, or the third one is going to be chemical hazards. Sometimes cross-contamination may also cause this food safety hazard. In many cases, a single hazard can introduce more than one type of the contamination to the food that we are consuming. The first one, microbiological or biological hazard. This occurs when food becomes contaminated by microorganisms which are found in air, food, water, soil, animals, and the human body. So these are all going to be of possessing the microflora. And this microflora, when it is going to come in contact with the food, then that we call it as a microbiological contamination. This biological contamination occurs when food becomes contaminated by any living organism. So here I told you about the microorganism. Here overall biological contamination is going to occur. So that may be animals or the human beings, all the things. So these include biological matters produced by humans, rodents, insects, and microorganisms. And the contamination of this biological organisms is going to lead to cause a foodborne illness and food poisoning. So that is intoxication as well as the food infections, and which are going to be the result or cause of food spoilage and food waste. There are six types of microorganisms that can cause foodborne illness. That is going to be of our bacteria, viruses, parasites, protozoa, fungi, and prions. So these are going to be the six major types of microorganisms which are responsible for causing the foodborne illness. This foodborne illness occurs when disease-causing microorganisms, which we generally call them as pathogens, gets into food and multiply to unsafe levels before being eaten. And this can happen remarkably and quickly. In conditions ideal for bacterial growth, one single bacteria can become 2 million in just 7 hours. So that's how the rapid multiplication of the bacteria leading to the more growth of these microorganisms. The bacteria and other pathogens thrive in the foods that are going to have the moist conditions, high in protein or starch, and neutral in acidity. So if a bacteria is going to have find of these kind of the atmospheric conditions, obviously it will thrive. That means it will grow more in number. These foods that meet these criteria are potentially hazardous or high risk foods. All high risk foods are teeming with pathogens and other bacteria, and this our responsibility, your or our responsibility, to stop bacteria from multiplying to unsafe levels, and where possible to destroy them by the cooking process. So we should stop this microbial growth by keeping the food safety levels as well as by cooking process. And another thing that we can do is by slow downing the growth of bacteria and prevent the food safety risk, you need to follow the food safety best practice designed to control the bacterial growth through proper food handling techniques that we have discussed in the previous part, rigorous cleaning, sanitization procedures, and time and temperature control of the food. So if we follow all these things, we can slow down or we can kill the microorganisms. The food poisoning can occur when specific toxins are consumed. That's we call it as food intoxication, where I explained in detail about this one in the different other foodborne illness videos. You can go through it. So such as those produced by Salmonella, Staphylococcus or Listeria. And microbial toxins are extremely potent toxins that can disable the immune system and damage our tissues if they are consumed. So that's the toxins are going to be highly poisonous. The best example is Clostridium botulinum, which causes the botulism disease, which is a result of botulinum toxin produced, which is a neurotoxin produced by Clostridium species. And many microbial toxins are heat resistant. So even if bacteria are destroyed in the cooking process, the toxins remain in the food and can cause violent and almost instantaneous symptoms. So this is all about the microbiological hazard and what are the things that we have to take to minimize the risk of this biological food contamination. So here we have to follow. The first one, keep high-risk foods out of the temperature danger zone. Second one, purchase, store, thaw, prepare, cook and serve high-risk foods properly. So we have to take the measure at each step. Okay. Then the third one, regularly clean and sanitize all food contact surfaces and the equipment. So whatever our dish, the spoons, spatulas, the surfaces, everything we have to sanitize and make it to be of very clean regularly. And maintain good overall hygiene, that means the food handler and as well as the person who is consuming have to have the good hygiene and sanitation of the premises. And maintain high standards of personal hygiene. So if it is an industrial purpose, all the employees have to do the same. So if we are going to follow these measures, obviously we can minimize the risk of biological food contamination that is occurring in our food. Either it may be in our home or it may be related to the food industry. Okay, so this is all about the microbiological hazard. Then moving to the second hazard or issue, that is a physical hazard. The physical contamination that is going to occur when a physical object enters into the food at some stage of the production or preparation process. So this physical objects in food can be choking hazard or often introduced biological contaminants as well. That means these may be the one of the way where the biological contaminants can enter. Even if the object is not likely to injure the customer who is consuming, or the person who is consuming, find an object, that means finding some sort of object, either it may be a stone or hay, something in our food can be very distressing for our cell, isn't it? Either it may be a customer or the person who is consuming the food containing these physical hazards. So usually results from accidental contamination and poor handling practices. So this physical hazards is because of this poor food handling practices. And here are some of the examples of physical contaminants that is going to contaminate our food. That is shivers of the glasses, human hair, nails, nail polish, pieces of jewelry, then metal fragments from worn or chipped utensils and containers, dirt, then stones, dirt from unwashed fruits and vegetables, frilled toothpicks. So these are all going to be some examples, common examples of physical contaminants that often we can absorb in the. Then how to minimize this risk of physical food contamination or physical hazards which are going to occur in our food or in the food businesses. So always if it is considered to be a business or in the kitchen, we are supposed to wear the hair neatly tied back or wear a hair or bird net. Then we have to keep our jewelry to a minimum. When necessary, wear brightly colored bandages that can be easily seen if they are fall off. We have to throw out and replace the cracked, chipped or broken dishware, glassware and equipment such that they won't be present in the as a remnants in our food. And use a plastic or metal scoop for ice. Never use the glass. Wash fruits and vegetables thoroughly because the dirt of these fruits and vegetables also may cause some sort of what we call it as a contamination or a hazard in our food preparation. Then establish pest prevention and control procedures as a part of our food safety plan. So these are the some of the things that we can apply to minimize the risk of physical hazard or physical food contamination. Then moving to the chemical hazards. So chemical contamination can occur when food comes in contact with or produces toxic chemicals, which can lead to the chemical food poisoning. And the chemical contaminants were going to be fall into two categories. One is going to be the natural and other one is going to be the artificial. And the general or common chemical contaminants are going to be of cleaning products, so that we use for as a detergents and sanitizers, then pesticides and the herbicides, then the toxic chemicals in metals and plastics and preservatives and naturally occurring toxins. So these are the few common chemical contaminants that we come often in the food contamination by chemical contaminants. The naturally occurring toxins which are going to be produced by certain organisms like shellfish, potatoes, fish, and even some of the bacteria are able to produce these toxins, but we consider that as a microbial hazard. Okay, so here if you find the shellfish, potatoes, fish are going to be of a major one which are producing toxic. So you may be very, what we call it as of why the potatoes are going to be considered as a toxins. So the potatoes here you can see, these potatoes are able to produce some sort of glycoalkaloids that are toxic to humans. And the majority of these toxins are contained in or just under the peel of the potato. And sometimes we can find those glycoalkaloids, that is toxins, in the eyes or the sprouts on the tomato, the germination. So you may see some sort of a small bud-like one that we can see on the potato. So those are going to possess these glycoalkaloids. And even if you see the green color skin on the potato, also indicates the presence of toxins. So be sure to remove any eye sprouts or green skin if you decide to use the potatoes that have greened or sprouted. So we have to remove those, that means we have to trim those parts and we are supposed to use it. And the minimal contamination with the natural toxins might not lead to the illness, because these may lead to the foodborne illness. But food handlers should be aware of which foods produce toxins and take all responsible precautions to ensure that the food is safe for consumption. So there are many ways that food can become contaminated by artificial or synthetic chemicals in a commercial kitchen. And the food handlers can accidentally cause chemical contamination if they, so what, how they are responsible of causing the chemical contamination means, if they don't store cleaning products and other chemicals properly, that is the sanitizers and detergents, then if they use too much detergents or sanitizers to clean food preparation surfaces, glassware, dishes or cutlery, then if they don't rinse surfaces or glassware, dishes or cutlery properly after cleaning and sanitization, if they don't properly wash fruits and vegetables to remove the pesticides, if they use kitchen equipment or containers made from materials that are not suitable for food or not designed to be reused, that is use only food grade plastics and metals, if they use the pest control products like spray, poison bait improperly, then they may be responsible of causing the chemical contamination in the food. Then how can we minimize the risk of chemical contamination or the chemical hazard? So we are always supposed to label and store chemicals separately from food. And we have to use the appropriate chemical for the job we are doing. Then we have to follow the chemical manufacturer's instructions with regards to dilution, contact time, and water temperature. Then we are supposed to use the chemical pest control products with extreme care or outsource pest eradication to a professional pest control service. So if we follow these rules or the things, obviously we will minimize the risk of chemical contamination. Then moving to the cross-contamination hazard. So this cross-contamination is the accidental transfer of contaminants from one source or one surface or substance to another. Usually the cross-contamination is going to be a result of improper handling procedures. So in a food setting, the term refers to the transfer of contaminants from a surface, object or person to food. That means from these surface, object, person, they are going to have the contamination to the food. And the cross-contamination usually refers to biological contamination, but can also be physical or chemical. So the cross-contamination initially in the things that I told you how to handle the food. So you should not handle both the vegetarian and the non-vegetarian at a time. Okay, because there may be a chance of cross-contamination. So that is maybe biological contamination, but sometimes physical or chemical contamination can also lead to this cross-contamination. Then this cross-contamination in food business often occurs as a result of food handlers, the one who handling the food. That means microorganism from sweat, sneezing, coughing, hands, hair and clothing. Then because of improper food handling techniques, that is reusing cutting boards or utensils for raw and cooked food or for different types of the food. Then improper cleaning and sanitization, that is not properly rinse cleaning chemicals from preparation surfaces, dishware, then glassware or equipment. Then improper food storage may also lead to the cross-contamination. Then improper waste disposal, so allowing the garbage containers to overflow, and even the pests are also responsible of causing the cross-contamination. So the cross-contamination can be by any of these. Then how to minimize the risk of cross-contamination? So we are supposed to cover and store raw food on shelves below cooked or ready to eat food in the refrigerator. That means raw food on the shelves below the cooked or ready to eat food. Then use separate equipment or utensils to prepare raw and cooked food. Then we have to use the separate equipment or utensils to prepare the different types of the foods. Okay, prepare allergen free meals separately. So those who are allergic for certain foods, so we are supposed to prepare the food separately for them. Establish allergen management procedures as a part of your or our food safety plan. So we have to maintain high standards of personal hygiene, the person who is handling or cooking all the time. Then wash hands frequently using the correct hand washing technique. So we had a technique how to wash our hands. Handle and dispose of food scraps and waste properly. That means ensure garbage containers are sealed and stored away from food. Then pest deserves a special mention in this regard, that is, as they are notorious sources of cross-contamination in the food business or food. So rodents, flies and cockroaches carry untold number of disease-causing bacteria and other pathogens on their bodies in their droppings and urea, that is urine and saliva, including the Salmonella, E. coli and Listeria. So if you follow all these things, then there may be a chance of having a minimizing the risk of cross-contamination of our food. So coming to the global food safety issues. So here you can see the mycotoxins, allergens, sanitation quality, pesticides, genetically, then general methods of followed. Then you are going to have this drug residues, plant diseases, foodborne bacteria. So these are all going to be the global issues that are going to be faced to overcome the contamination such that the food is going to be safe. So if you observe here, these are all going to be the things. So foodborne bacteria. So here, if we see the foodborne bacteria like salmonellosis, botulism, then botulism, then staphylococcus intoxication, all are because of the foodborne bacteria. So, and that is going to be seen worldwide, not in a specific period, region, okay, or area. Then moving to the drug residues. So there may be a chance of having the illness due to the presence of drugs or the residues that were remnant in the food. So that is also going to be affecting it. Then GMO is going to have some sort of a safety rules. That means we are supposed to follow the safety rules throughout the globe, such that we can keep our food safe. Then allergens, some people are going to be allergic to some kind of the foods. For example, some may be allergic to milk, some may be allergic to foods such as potato, brinjal, like that. So they must be aware of having which food is going to be allergic to them. And then the sanitation or quality. So here the sanitation or quality means nothing but the food handlers on the surroundings, everything should be of hygienic in conditions. Then plant diseases. So some of the fungal diseases are going to be transmitted to the food, and that may be causing the diseases to the humans or animals or the poultry. So we must be aware of these plant diseases. Okay, then mycotoxins. So especially we had discussed this mycotoxins in detail in one of my video. You can go through it, which how dangerous it is. So aflatoxins, all these toxins, and which is going to be present throughout the globe and causing some sort of issues in the food safety level. So these are the few issues that we can see throughout the world or throughout the globe. Then stakeholders were involved in how to food safety. So here are the first one, research institutes or laboratories, which are going to assign the quality of the food that we are going to have, so such that the food is going to be the safe. And then the industries, production levels, sanitization conditions, everything have to be maintained by them, and they have to see. And farmer organizations, then consumer organizations, there they are going to have the how to maintain the crops and what are the benefits of using the different fertilization. So educating the farmers to use the maintain the hygienic or how to produce, everything is a farmer organization. And coming to the consumer organization, here we are going to see how the food is and what is the quality of it, how to consume it. So all the things are going to be taken by the consumer organization. Then government agencies are mainly involved in giving the certification to concerned food products, such or otherwise. At the same time, they are also responsible to seal that food industry if it is not going to follow the food safety rules. Then coming to the regulators, so these are mainly involved in regulating the systems. Okay, so these are the few stakeholders. Then moving to the some challenges to food safety, what that it is going to continue to emerge largely because of changes in our food production and supply, including more important foods. Then changes in the environment leading to food contamination. Then better detection of multi-state outbreaks, the new and emerging bacteria, toxins and antibiotic resistant bacteria. Then changes in the consumer preferences and habits, and changes in the tests that diagnose the foodborne illness. So because of all these changeovers, it is going to be a new challenge every time to have the food safety. Okay, so that's all about the food safety issues. In the next part, we will discuss about the food safety systems. Thank you.